This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Know-How is brought to you by CashFly.
This episode of Know-How is brought to you by Tracker, a coin-sized tracking device that pairs with your smartphone and keeps you from losing your most valued possessions. Visit thetracker.com right now and enter the promo code KNOWHOW to receive a free Tracker Bravo with any purchase. And by the Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It's like caller ID for your house. Go to ring.com/knowhow and get up to $150 off a Ring of Security kit with their limited time offer. Today on Know-How,
Steampunk Goggles version 2.
Welcome to Know-How. It's a Twitch show where we build, bend, break, and upgrade. I am Father Robert Ballas here.
And I'm Brian Burnett.
And for the next however many minutes it takes, we're going to be dropping some rainbows into your brain with some steampunk goggles. Brian,
what's up?
You seem to be, you've got something growing out of your head.
You know what? These are still pretty amazing. These are probably one of the more simple projects that we've done, but definitely the ones that stand out.
I was at the first competition. That's the robotics competition, the high school circuit. And all these wonderful, very expensive robots. And people kept asking me where they could make one of those. I'm like, okay. So I had little cards. I'm like, okay, just go to here. Go to here. Get the
files. Just go to our site. Oh, the show notes at twit.tv/KH.
Oh, yeah.
Where you can find all our episodes.
Although,
subscribe or download.
One of the issues was that the code and the STL files for those
disappeared
because Dropbox decided to get kind of ornery.
Right.
But it's fine because now we're doing version 2.
Well, speaking of things that disappear, didn't these disappear at some point?
Yeah, I had the original prototypes just disappeared. Just someone really liked them, so they just said, I think I should have these.
They disappeared.
That's okay. But you know what? They're relatively easy to make, and that's exactly what we're going to do.
Cool.
We're going to show you not just how we put these together, but also how you rev your designs, because we've gone from a version 1 to a version 1.2. Now we're at version 2, so we're going to show you the natural progression of the mind of a maker.
Now, wait, you're saying you didn't get these perfect the first time you did this?
Oh, no.
The 3D print that you did the first time was great?
Well, you'll know, Brian, that once you start tinkering with 3D printing especially, there's never perfect. You could have the greatest design ever and you will come back in a week and go,
that's part of the fun,
I don't
though,
remember
right?
why I did it that way.
I don't know why it fell apart on itself. Maybe I'll try it different.
And that's exactly what we're going to be fixing with this. Now, you notice when you put those down at the beginning, there's a little issue with viewing through the glass while you've got the lights on, yes?
Where'd you go?
Okay, and that's why I designed those to be worn up on the forehead or on a hat. If you try to actually wear these and you turn on that's the brightest animation.
I'm not going to describe it the way I did earlier before we started the show, but yeah, it's like staring into the face of a rainbow or something.
Right, and that's because there was two pieces of glass in there, and what's happening is the LED light ring is up against one piece of glass, but you still get enough of a scattering off that second piece where it bounces back into your eyes. Not the best thing to do.
It's a little distracting. I wouldn't want to walk around on a busy street with these on, and also because of the way that they're extended from your... I mean, they're welding goggles, right?
Right.
So they kind of protrude from your face a little bit and then block the sides,
well,
a little blinders.
That's the whole steampunk look.
Yeah, no, totally.
And of course, because it's not true steampunk, it's just kind of know-how punk. That little little knob on your right-hand side there, Brian, if you rotate that, what's going to happen is it actually changes the animation pattern. So, and we've learned how to do this. This was a project from a year ago. So you've seen the code for this. We've used it as examples time and time again. I think there's six or seven different animations in that one.
Yeah, and what you had done is, so this is just the little, the PWM dial,
that's just a potentiometer hooked into the analog, and then I'm going to use a mapping function to turn the value from the potentiometer into a digital value that selects one of the animation patterns.
Exactly, and then you even added fade to black, right? When I go,
Right, because I didn't just want it to turn off, so it actually kind of fade. And it's those little weird things that, you know, I wanted to upgrade, and it bothered me enough where I said, no, we have to do revision 2. Actually, if you hand it to me, let me show you some of the other issues that I've had with this. So, first of all, I did like the design. I didn't want to change the design too much. So, you know, you still have, you've got the little, the brass gears that Steampunk is known for. You've got the little magnifying loop. This has been slightly modified over the months just to make this a bit easier to stay in place. We've also added a couple of extra brass gears. There's been a few pieces that I really didn't like. First of all, this. So this is just a piece of heat shrink tubing. Mm-hmm. It's not the best look. I mean, it doesn't really bother me that much because you can't see it from a distance. But
and it fits in with the steampunk kind of style.
It does, but I was wondering if I could do something a little bit better. The other thing I didn't like is this. So on the underside, this right here, this looks fine. And actually, it's a good design for these goggles. But the problem is this is high enough where it actually touches the bridge of your nose.
And that, it becomes uncomfortable.
It becomes very, very uncomfortable. So I wanted to change that. I wanted to fix that so that this is not protruding up into your flesh. The other thing is, and this was because I got lazy towards the end of the design process, the Arduino, which is on this side, and the battery on this side, are just kind of shoved in there. I've got a little riser on each end that kind of holds it in, but and this is held in with double-sided tape, and this is just kind of wedged. So I wanted to fix that. And I also wanted to make this easier to upgrade. In other words, I'm pretty happy with where the frame is, but I want to be able to upgrade the electronics and the power plant as the technology changes and as my needs change. Like, for example, with this one battery, This pair of goggles can go for about 4 hours.
It's pretty good.
But, you know, I couldn't put in a 2S battery in there and go the entire day if I needed to.
Something about having a 2S battery hooked up to my head kind of frightens me. But if you say it'll work,
have a 2S battery plugged into your head, Ryan.
I could always use a little extra brain power.
Okay, so now let's take a look at version 2. Just so you see some of the differences. We're going to put them on one on top of the other. If you go to the side view, so they look very similar.
Very similar, although the version 2 looks a little bit more streamlined.
It is more streamlined. So this was actually designed from the ground up. So I took the basic cup shape of the bracket that holds it to the goggles, but everything else has been redesigned. And you know what? My skills as a 3D designer have improved greatly over the last year, so I didn't make nearly as many mistakes.
Yeah,
so just it looks better. It feels better. It fits a lot better. If you'll notice, like on the cup right here, this now descends so it doesn't actually rub against your nose. It doesn't cover the bottom of the goggles entirely anymore, but it's better for comfort, much better for comfort. The other thing is I've redesigned this. Before, I basically just hacked a spot in the side of the goggles where I could fit this. This is actually custom designed, so this potentiometer fits perfectly. It's you know, I really kind of like that.
Yeah, it looks like you've designed your own little 3D printed nut.
Yeah, see this was the knob control from just a standard potentiometer. And you notice like it's coming kind of loose. The brass gear's not quite turning with it.
It disgusts me now.
It does. This is the same potentiometer, but it's now, this gear is actually the potentiometer knob.
Nice.
And I kind of like this exposed industrial look. That's very steampunky.
Top view.
Top view. There we go. See. Ha ha. That's how it looks. Okay. Now the one of the other things that I've changed is look at the bridge. So if we look at the bridge of the old one,
looks like you 3D printed a little bridge.
Yeah. So this is just heat shrink. These are little segments. These are little bridge segments that go on over the bridge, and that's actually the cable guide. So the cable runs through there.
Huh.
And it keeps it nice and clean, but it kind of keeps it it gives it that uniform look.
Right, and you have a little break in between so it still can bend.
Flexible, I still want it to be flexible. But the biggest change has to be the way that the Arduino and the battery are stored. You'll notice this is no longer just stuck in there.
No.
This is actually a cartridge, so I can pull this cartridge out and change the Arduino when I want to reprogram it or if I need a more powerful Arduino.
Okay, that's pretty cool. Yeah, that's smart.
Same thing on this side. So the battery, this can actually hold two battery packs now, two of these.
What?
And I can modify this bay so that I could hold bigger batteries, and the battery compartment actually just comes out. So this is a cartridge that plugs into the side of the goggles.
So you just hot swap.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And I was kind of geeking out.
It's totally impractical, but yeah. No, the difference between 2 and 1 is pretty substantial.
And the other thing is this is a good 50, even though it's got more support members in it, this is 50 grams lighter than this.
Why is that?
Because, again, I didn't know 3D design really well, so the wall length is not really uniform. It goes from 3 millimeters up top to like 6 millimeters down below.
Wow.
lot of excess material, way too much material. I've also done away with the interior piece of glass, and those are actually kind of heavy on welding glasses.
So with the glass on this one, did you just leave the tinted on the front?
Yeah, so this was something else I wanted to change. So if I turn this off, so let's go to...
You can see the little LED.
Yeah, you can see, there's no surprise. You know exactly what's in there, right? Yeah. If you turn this off... the other way.
That's like the perfect amount of tint to hide it.
Right, yeah, see? That's so cool. You don't know it's there. Unless you're like, I think I can get an angle on this where you can see them. No, I can't. So, I mean, if someone just sees these, they look like welding goggles, and then you flip the switch.
And then boom.
Boom. And that's kind of the effect I want.
That
right?
is really cool. Yeah, it's more stealthy.
It's the disappearing goggles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I try them on?
Oh, yeah. Sure.
See if they really are more comfortable.
See if you like them, Brian.
I might walk away with them. Oh, yeah, these are more comfortable.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, because it doesn't cut into my nose.
And, yeah, see, the thing is, I didn't notice that at first, but if you wear it for longer than 10 minutes, you start to go, why is my nose itching? It's because the thing's cutting into
these
it.
These are, they feel a lot lighter.
They are a lot lighter. 50 grams on your head is a lot less, because remember, that elastic band has to hold it, and so if it's a heavier device, it just kind of stretches out. It just makes your head feel uncomfortable.
Now, what if you wear them both at the same time?
That's a good look.
Right? It's way better like this. Two is better. Yeah, it does like that. Oh, you should totally make that animation. Do green and then have them twist side to side.
Okay, well, this is good. Okay, Brian, let's continue. Okay. Let's continue. Okay. So what we're going to do is this is actually a two-part episode. The first part is I'm going to show you some of the design changes that we've made. I'm also going to show you the code because the code has changed. I've also added a couple of extra animations towards the end. So, you know, I've got all the ones I had at the beginning, but also there's this one. I actually call it the warp core because I originally designed this animation to run on a full-size warp core that I made.
A full-sized warp core?
Well, full-size, scale warp size. Core.
Like, do you have enough space for that?
It uses a series of WS2812 LEDs, and it like pulses just like the original warp core. And yeah, and then, nice. Wait, actually, if you go back to the close-up, we go from that to... It's the dual warp core.
Oh,
we're so mesmerized, Brian.
You are nerding out so hard right now.
So I think that one had 7 animations. This one has 10.
Very cool.
Right. So, but let's go ahead and start taking a look at the actual design cues, the little pieces that we've created, and how we've changed them. We've gone from version 1 to version 2.
Yeah, I want to see how you got
to make it a little bit better. The first thing we got to take a look at is this. So these are the frame. So I've got one for the right and one for the left. What I did last time, and again, this was owing to my inexperience, was I designed the left and the right separately.
Instead of just designing one side and then mirroring it?
Right, exactly. Which, yeah, I should have done, but I didn't because I was in the rush to get it all done. So this is actually the same design. The only difference is I created a baseline design, then I mirrored it, and then I changed just enough between the two so that they could individually be what they were for. So this side is for the potentiometer. So it's got the 6.5 millimeter hole there, plus inside here it's got the little you can't really see it. There's a guide for the potentiometer.
In the top shot.
Here we go. Let's see if I can get see that secondary hole?
Yeah.
What that does is that keeps this potentiometer, which also has a little pedo.
Right, keeps it from moving around.
Right, because what you don't want is you don't want it becoming loose, and then when you rotate the potentiometer, the entire potentiometer changes, not just the shaft. That would be bad.
Does it do that on the first version? No.
No, but because I had a holder in there, but the holder was just the side of the frame.
If you
crank hard enough, you will actually, yeah. This and then on this side, you'll notice that there's a much smaller hole, and I've also extended. Let's see if I can get the reflection right. I've extended the little standoff in the top,
I see
there we go. Because I didn't want all the force to be right up against the frame. A problem I had with the original was because...
For these guys, right?
Right. This tends to want to flex. Yeah. This is not flexing. There's no way that's going to flex.
Cool.
And let's actually look at the 3D design. If you go to my computer here, Alex, so this is what it looks like in Tinkercad. And of course, it thinks it needs to restart.
You sure you didn't want to update right now?
Say no, Padre.
How are you gonna?
Oh, Windows, go away. Here we go. This is the goggle frame. So this is what the baseline looks like. There's this little cup, which is essentially an oblong piece that I've slanted, and then taking a chunk out of the middle. I did this much better than I did last time. Last time what I did was I made one piece and then I made small slices to cut into the piece to give me my empty space. That's not good because what you end up with is just wall thickness that, again, varies from 3 millimeters up to 6 millimeters.
It's not uniform. I mean, if you've never played with Tinkercad before, it is a very...
It's easy to get into.
It's easy to get into, but as soon as you start doing angles and stuff, I found it extremely difficult that sort of angle. So how did you do it?
Well, I did it in little pieces. So I would design one piece, export it, import it into an integration. That's why this is Steampunk V2I1, so it's an integrated drawing. Okay. The other thing that they've added in Tinkercad, and this is fantastic, thank you very much for doing this, is I can remove a piece without deleting it. So I can do this. I can hide it. So it's still there.
Nice.
But now I can work inside when I need to fix individual components of my 3D design. And then when I hit this, it just comes
back in. That's perfect. That's like layers in Photoshop.
Precisely. So I can get rid of something like these individual pieces and work on my design without having to delete the elements that I've taken so long to create.
Right, without interfering with the view. Yeah. Very cool.
The other thing that you'll notice is, see this curve? That's
the nose bridge, right?
Right, that's the nose bridge. So I've added a little bit of a slant there to slice away that material. And same thing here. You don't actually notice it, but this is curved down by about 1 degree. And the reason why we do that, it just fits better on the frame. It looks a little bit better. And any material that I can remove makes it lighter. So I actually decreased the wall thickness around the inside here. I learned that I actually don't need a full 4 millimeters of material to keep it rigid around the goggle, so I got rid of that.
Yeah, no, these feel solid. And I think, too, if you wanted to add a little bit of extra comfort, you could probably put, like, a little foam or some sort of, like, a little tape or something so it doesn't have such a sharp edge on the inside of the bridge. But it just basically now your nose rests on the goggles, the original goggles, not the 3D printed design.
Right, right. Okay, now let's take a look at something else. The cartridges. This is the most different part of version 2 over version 1.
It's because, like, a magazine that goes into a...
the original version I had, when you popped it in, it did a self-lock and it was like, it clicked.
But then how do you get back out?
Well, no, then you had to like reach in and press the button and pull it out. Hmm. It was cool, but the problem is I'm like, that thing is going to break.
Yeah.
And when it breaks, then it'll just either get jammed in or out. So
So what did you do instead?
Simplicity, super simplicity. So this is what the basic cartridge design looks like. It's actually, what I did was I took this piece right here, I'm going to turn it solid. I took that piece and I basically hollowed it out.
Oh, that makes sense. So, and just kind of shrunk it by maybe
precisely.
A millimeter.
It makes it perfectly able to fit into the cavity that I've created.
And then how does it lock in, or does it just?
Well, if you look here, if you look at the side here, there's this. So this piece actually holds it in there, and it's just the friction. The friction is enough to keep it in there.
So not only is it probably a little structural arch to help support the sides of the goggle, but it also works for that. That's
yes,
awesome.
Yes, it does. Yeah, and the thing is this. This is 2 millimeters down to 1 millimeter.
Oh,
so it's a whole lot, this is why it's so much lighter. It's a whole lot thinner than the original version, but it has the same strength because I put that cross member piece.
I mean, it might be kind of hard to tell in the camera.
It's because of the angle.
And they're black, you know. Yeah. But yeah, that's a big difference. That's almost half of what the thickness between that and that.
Yeah, yeah. Cool. And you know, anytime you can remove material, you can remove weight. Makes it more comfortable.
And it's still as strong.
So. Oh, yeah, yeah. But, okay, so back to this design. This was the side for the battery. So what I did was I made it the right size to hold that battery. I have all this extra space that I could make a second cartridge that could accommodate a larger battery,
a larger cartridge. Yeah.
And you'll notice there's little holes in the bottom, and that's because I've made little doors for this that can actually lock over the top. This was another thing that I had, which is the back of the goggles are open.
Open, yeah.
Which... it's not a problem.
No.
But, you know, if you don't like that look, that unfinished look,
right.
I made a little something super light that actually fits over the top. And this is what it looks like. So, Alex, if you show this, this is the little modules that I've made. So this, it's just a door.
Oh, that's awesome.
So it goes in there and then clicks in.
Well, and if you were ever worried about it sprinkling, like, you know, on your head, if a little bit of rain, that seems like it would kind of protect
it. Totally waterproof now, man. You can take this underwater. That will totally, see, look, that stops the water.
Mm-hmm, definitely. It's sealed.
And actually, if you take a look at this, this is what the door, so this is what the Arduino catch looks like. So it's the same kind of cartridge. The only thing that's different is they've changed what's inside. So there's this little, I actually originally designed this for the Nanobox. So I took the Arduino holder template from the Nanobox and I put it into the side cartridge. And then I created this. So this is the actual door. And what I did was I just took a single slice of the cartridge, the original cartridge file. Let me just hide this away, like so.
Wow.
And then I have created this.
Yep.
This little mechanism that allows me to lock it in.
Right. It's got the little three, well, I guess they're what, turquoise or light blue bumps that should fall into the little latch holes.
Right. And actually, if I show everything, you can see how that fits in. So it fits into the little hole that I created at the bottom there, and it fits in, it just latches onto the top of the frame.
It looks like a little space shuttle.
It does, right? It's so cute. Oh, another thing that they've changed in Tinkercad, and you're gonna like this, is they've actually given you the ability to choose the coarseness or the roughness of the design. Alex, if you go back here, if you look at this.
Really?
So let me hide this again.
Because I thought that was just determined by the resolution that you chose for the print.
No, see this, I can change the number of segments and I can change the radius and it changes how the actual part looks like. So I can give it a more rounded look. See how that's changing that?
Wait, on the red block there?
Yeah, look on the red block, see?
Oh, okay, yeah.
There we go. And I can I can choose, do I want it to look a little industrial or do I want it to be as smooth as possible?
Yeah.
It increases the complexity of the print, but if you really want that rounded shape, that's how you do it.
So what printer are you using for this project? Was it the Dremel?
Both. So I've used both the Dremel and my Monoprice Maker Select version 2.
Okay.
And the reason why I did that was because I wanted to make sure that whatever the audience is using, the 3D print, could do this project properly.
And both of those printers worked fine on this project?
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
and
cool.
The one thing you might have a problem with is the door. If your printer is subpar, it may not print the things right.
Because that seems like a pretty fine little piece, the door.
I mean, look at this. This thing is, as thin as I wanted to make it, because it still bends, but it's got just enough support to keep its shape.
Oh, yeah.
But I didn't want to add, 10, 15 grams just for a door.
No, this is perfect.
Yeah.
And it doesn't, I mean, it bends and it's flexible, but it doesn't feel like it's going to snap or brittle.
Right.
Cool. And okay. This is all PLA, right?
All PLA. Nothing toxic. Now let's go ahead and run down the parts that you're going to need for this build. Of course, you're going to need all these 3D parts. So you're going to need the left frame and the right frame. These are the little LED holders. And the nice thing, the way that I've designed this version is these, they snap in. So they are secured. This is just high enough. The interior rim is just high enough so that it pushes it up against the glass and you get very little bleed through.
Yeah, okay.
So, and then, so you're not looking through
reflecting.
Poop.
Yeah, a unicorn butthole is how I described it, yeah.
And then on the bottom side, you'll notice that there's a little cutout, and what that cutout is for is so that I have the ability to, let's do it with a new one, I have the ability to line this up with where my soldering pads are.
Right, so you can thread the wires through the back of it. Yeah.
God, it's so tight. And then, there it is. So that's where my wires go.
You know, I hadn't noticed it the first time I put them on, but there is zero bleed through, really.
Yep.
I mean, this is way easier to see out of these. Even though the glass is tinted, I can see better
with that. Well, because, you don't want the headlights to be blowing into your eyeballs.
Right. That would be bad.
That'd be bad. All right. So, and then we also, of course, we have the cartridges, the left and the right. And I've given you all the design files so you can modify them for the types of parts that you're gonna be using. Of course, you're gonna need the two WS2812 rings. Alex, I think we have links for these. These are gonna be about $4 a pop. Mm-hmm. These are the 16-bit, so 16 LED. Get a bunch of these. They're so useful. I love it, man. They are the perfect size for these goggles, which I love. Now, you're going to need the base. And the base is, you want to use vintage steampunk goggles. We've got an Amazon link for this. They look like this. And
they're pretty basic.
They're super basic. You can actually buy steampunk goggles that have been ready-made, and they have like the little loop on them. But let's make it.
Yeah, totally.
The reason why we're getting these is because we can remove this. So this is the part that the frame actually locks against. It's why it's got that beveled look.
Mm-hmm.
And inside, there's a clear piece of glass, a gasket, and then the tinted glass, and that's all I'm going to use. I'm going to put the LED right up against that tinted glass, and that gets locked in as the new assembly. So
cool.
If you go to the overhead, Alex, so ultimately the way it's going to work is this is actually replacing one of the lenses, which is why it's lighter. Then I put the gasket, and I put the top piece of glass, and then this locks right over the top.
Boom. And you don't even know it's there anymore.
Don't even know it's there. And what we did with the old one was there was a similar design to the LED holder, but it just went on the inside of the goggles like that, which works, but again, you get a lot of that light scatter,
yeah.
Bleed through, and it's not as cool.
No,
I kind of like it locked in with the lens. And again, it disappears, so you don't actually see it until you turn it on.
I know we've used this word on the show before, which doesn't seem to be true, but these are sexy.
They're sexy.
Yeah, these are way more.
They're how you say.
Because you know how you gave me all the parts to build own steampunk goggles originally? I'm like, yeah, that's cool. I really want to build the new ones.
There you go.
Version 2. That's
version
the way
two.
To go.
Well, that's
Wait until Padre iterates the next version.
Yeah. That's how it works. We're also going to need some gears. So actually, if you show them the link for the gears, I just get a big grab bag and then I choose what I like. So you can buy this for $7 and then you choose the gears that kind of fit you. I've seen people who will glue extra gears onto their steampunk goggles. If that's your thing, that's your thing. I kind of like the minimalist approach.
It's like, what was that restaurant that has little bits of flair?
Yeah.
If you have more flair, it's better, right?
Yeah, it's flair's good.
Flair.
You're also going to need a potentiometer, a 10K potentiometer. We've got a link for this. These are super cheap, folks. You can get a 10-pack of these things for $3. So get yourself a 10-pack. Don't be super cheap and try to get one. You're also going to need an Arduino Nano. These are going to run you between $2 and $4. I always buy them in bulk, so I get them super cheap.
Right.
I went with the Nano rather than something like a Stamp or a Mini Pro, just because I kind of do like the USB port rather than having to use.
How much smaller is the other one?
It's like half the size.
Half.
Yeah, but I didn't need it. I got space. So
yeah.
It's like, why use the super small one that's crippled when I can use a larger one that I have space for?
Mm-hmm.
You're also going to need battery connectors, the Walkera battery connectors. These are about... and I bought them in bulk, and I got them for like 10 cents each. But you can buy this. It's a 1-6 balance charger, and then just cut them off.
Oh, okay.
It's actually cheaper than trying to buy a single connector.
All right, that's not bad.
Yeah. And then 30-gauge silicone wire, or 32-gauge silicone wire, depending on how thin you want these. 32
right.
is the absolute thinnest I'd go. 30 is what I'm using. And you just need enough to get power from one side to the other and signal.
You're just using the battery we're using. That's just the little 5-volt ones, the same ones that we use for the Simas.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, 3.7.
3.7
is nominal, and then 4.1 is what they put out.
So what's that bring the grand total to then?
Well, it's 3.7.
So the build.
For everything, if you were to buy everything just as I mapped them out, it's going to cost you $40.
That's awesome.
Yeah, but you do need a 3D printer, so.
Oh, yeah, I guess that's a bit of
or
an investment.
Or have a friend.
Who has
3D print the frame.
Or, I mean, I guess you could download the STL files and then, was it Thingiverse?
Yeah,
Shapeways. Yeah.
Or Thingiverse actually has an integration with them.
Yeah, and then they'll ship you the parts.
Yeah.
It'll be a little bit more expensive, but cheaper than buying a whole 3D printer if you don't have one.
Now, here's
Excuse
the fun
me,
thing.
Padre, right? You forgot one.
Oh, yes, the loop. Well, how could I forget that?
Oh, my.
Yes, you're going to need this. Again, it's optional, but I mean, folks, look. Look at that. It's so cute, the loop. And actually... Believe it or not, this is functional.
Really?
I was using this the other night. It's actually the perfect height to get it right over my eye.
See, 3 seems excessive. Do you need to have all 3?
Well, the closer you get, the more you use. So if it's minorly close, you use a single, like that. And then if you're getting a little bit more magnification, you use 2. And if you want extreme magnification, you use 3. Actually, you can kind of see it. Look, it magnifies the lights, Brian. Do we just
oh, okay.
No.
I didn't know what to say to that. I do like the gears are functional and you haven't gone too far with them because don't use more than
I liked the original design, so I didn't want to depart from it completely. I just wanted to make it better.
Form and function. I like it.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Now what we want to do next is we want to show you the integration video from the original because the electronics are actually not that much different. I've added a little bit of flexibility with that cartridge system.
Yeah.
But putting it together is the same. So we're gonna re-show you. We're going to pull out something from the old know-how closet and air it out a little bit.
You see some moss fly off of it.
Yeah. But before we get to that, these messages. Folks, you know And I know, one of the most frustrating things that can happen is that you have a new gadget, a new gizmo, something that's wonderful, something that's shiny, something that makes you complete, and then you lose it. Yeah, we all know that feeling, that little knot in the pit of our stomach as we've walked away from our favorite device and we can't locate it, or even worse, you're in a public space and it walks away on its own. Wouldn't it be nice if there was a way for you to make sure that all of your best stuff, all of your most productive gear, all of your favorite toys and gizmos would always be within reach? Well, that gizmo does exist, and it's called the Tracker. Now, this is the Tracker. It's a coin-sized device, nice and small, something that you can link onto your keys, onto your laptop bag, onto your pet. And it allows you to stay linked up to the device wherever it might be. Now, here's how it works. It uses Bluetooth LE, which is a low-energy version of Bluetooth, and it pings the device, the phone, that it's connected to. Now, you can pair up to 10 different devices, and once you're paired up, you will always be able to locate exactly where that device is. Now, it's not just location. It also gives you separation alerts. So if you start walking away from your device, the Tracker can warn you. And if you lose your device, you can actually push the button on the back of the Tracker and it will make it ring even if it's on silent. A Tracker is the best way to just put your mind at ease, whether you're at your workout, your shower, whether or not you're walking to the corner coffee shop. It's the perfect companion to all of your most important things. Now, the Tracker Bravo is this coin-sized device constructed with anodized aluminum for the thinnest, most durable tracking ever. You can just pair a Tracker to your smartphone, and once you've attached it, you have that two-way connectivity. Now, here's my absolute favorite part about Tracker. You don't have to be within range. I mean, Bluetooth range. I mean, yeah, Bluetooth is going to run out after about 30 or so feet, but with Tracker, because they've got so many trackers in the wild, as long as your Tracker is within range of any Tracker user, you can still get a hit. You can still get a ping. In other words, if someone takes your phone and goes to the other side of the city, if someone takes your workout bag and moves to the other side of the gym, even if it's not within range of your phone, as long as it's within the range of a phone of another Tracker user, you can still get a location hit. That's my favorite part, this whole mesh crowdsourced GPS. Folks, that's the future. That's Tracker. With over 4.5 million devices shipped, that crowd GPS will keep you in reach no matter where your thing may go. And the distance indicator on the Tracker will also show you if you're getting closer to your item, so if you really want to locate it, you can play a little game of submarine and go after your gear. And with a 30-day money-back guarantee, there's now no reason not to give it a try. If you value your gear, if you're tired of losing your stuff, if you hate separation anxiety, you owe it to yourself to try the Tracker. Stop losing your stuff today. Go to thetracker.com and enter the promo code KNOWHOW. You'll get a free Tracker Bravo with any order. That's the Tracker, thetracker.com. Promo code KNOWHOW for your free Tracker Bravo with any order. Tracker, never lose your stuff again. And we thank Tracker for their support of KNOWHOW. Okay, Brian, so let's get to it. Mm-hmm. We had version 1 and version 2. Version 2 has made a couple of alterations, but...
Yeah.
It's mostly the same electronically as version 1. So without further ado, hey Alex, show us how you put together some steampunk goggles.
Project Steampunk starts with the goggles, WS2812 rings, silicone wire, some heat shrink tubing, a Dremel, a soldering kit, an Arduino Nano, battery, and battery harness. The first step is to decouple the two goggle cups. Gently pull on the bridge strap until it slips from one of the cups. You should now have two cups, which will be much easier to manipulate than the set. Besides, we're going to add a piece of heat shrink tubing to the bridge, so we would need to eventually separate them at some point in the build. We might as well do it now. The trickiest part of this build will be getting the power and data lines into the eye cups without destroying the look of the goggles. We're going to drill a rat hole at the bottom of the bridge next to the nose cutout. We want to drill at an angle. It should keep the wiring out of eyesight while also letting us hide excess wire in the 3D printed housing. Using a Dremel with a spear bit, drill from the outside in. Go slowly. If you break through the interior wall and touch the lens, there's a good chance that you'll permanently damage the look. The hole needs to be big enough for 6 strands of 30 gauge silicone wire. Test by running 6 strands just to make sure it will fit. You don't want to have to drill again after you start running the electronics into the goggles. Let's talk about our game plan for the electronics. We have two WS2812 rings with 16 LEDs each. They fit perfectly into the cups, and we now have the rat holes we need to run the wiring. Looking at the back of each ring, you'll see 6 soldering pads. Top to bottom, GND, or ground, VCC, voltage, out, in, VCC, and ground. These pads will allow us to pass voltage and data from one ring to the next. Power can come from either side, so we simply need to connect one ring's data out to the next ring's data in. However, we're not doing a straight-through installation with power and data coming from the same side. The Arduino will be on the right side, while the battery will be on the left. That means that power needs to be daisy-chained from the battery to the left cup to the right cup to the Arduino, while data needs to be chained from the Arduino to the right cup to the left cup. You'll need to cut the following lengths of wire. For red and black, 2 6-inch lengths each, and 1 8-inch length each. For the white wire, or whatever color you're using for data, 1 6-inch length and 1 8-inch length. Cut, strip, and tin your lengths. Then prep the pads on the LED rings by flowing a dollop of solder onto each pad. Make sure to heat the pad, not the solder, and let it flow onto the pad. This will ease our soldering job later in the build. Cut a piece of 1/4-inch black heat shrink tubing that is slightly shorter than the length of the bridge strap. This is what will hide the wires running across that strap. Take the 3 8-inch lengths of red, black, and white silicone wire and run them through the heat shrink tubing. Then make sure that the tubing will still fit over the bridge piece with the wires inside towards the back of the bridge. If they don't fit, your heat shrink tubing is undersized and needs to be replaced. Run the wires through the rat hole in the left cup, then reconnect the bridge. Now get to soldering the LED ring for the left cup. The power can go through either set of points, so just make sure that the red wire is soldered to VCC and the black wire to ground. The white wire is a little trickier. We need the data to go from the Arduino to the right cup to the left cup, so make sure that you solder the data wire to the in pad on this ring. When we connect the other end of the data line to the out pad on the other ring, it will complete the daisy chain. Now, take 2 6-inch wires, one black and one red, and run them through the left cup rat hole. Solder the red one to the remaining VCC pad and the black one to the remaining GND pad. Check your work and make sure that the solder joints are solid. Remember that these wires will be close to your eyes, so you don't want stray wires snapping off inside your goggles. Also, make sure that you haven't bridged any of the pads. Once you're satisfied with your joints, place the LED ring inside the cup and draw back the slack wire. The power source will be stored in the left 3D printed frame, and we're using a male battery connector that we cut from our multi-charging harness. Connect the black and red leads of the charging plug to the remaining black and red leads that we ran through the left cup rat hole. Draw the slack wire through the heat shrink tubing and run the three wires into the right cup rat hole. Then solder black to GND, red to VCC, and white to out. Run the remaining 6-inch lengths of black, red, and white wire through the right cup rat hole, then solder red to VCC, black to GND, and white to in. These three wires will deliver power to the Arduino and data from the Arduino to both LED rings. Once again, check your solder joints for connection and bridging, then place the LED ring inside the cup. The final step is to connect our Arduino Nano. Looking at the Arduino from the top with the USB port on the left side, solder the black wire to the GND or ground through hole, the red wire to the VIN or voltage in, and the white data line to D3. Once you've inspected your solder joints and double-checked all your connections, it's time for the moment of truth. Connect the 3.7-volt battery pack to the battery connector, and you should see the LED rings briefly flash, and the power light on the Arduino should come on. If that happens, you're ready to program.
In next week's episode, what we're going to do is we're actually going to show you the final integration. Mm-hmm. And guess what, Brian?
What?
I actually made two sets of these. So we're going to do a let's solder.
Sweet. You know how much I love let's solders.
In real time, we get 1 hour to assemble our goggles. Win or lose, we're going to get to the end of the show, and we will have made or broken something.
That's good, because I thrive under pressure, especially when it comes to soldering.
And also, I made two working sets, so we can.
Oh, just in case. Yeah. They're like, oh, let us put this in the oven. Look, it's done
it's
now.
So 5 minutes later, we have a cooked turkey.
It's perfect.
Although, the magic of television, folks.
The only thing that makes less solders better is if Smitty's on. He's not going to come on, is he?
I got him for a future episode, but I'm like, he doesn't have a kit, so he would just be staring at us going,
just watching.
That's bad. No, that's bad. Don't do that.
And then
that's,
we'd start crying. Yeah.
Yeah. I feel that my Smitty Humble Pie should only come maybe once every 4 or 5 months.
That's all we can handle, because otherwise we'll just feel too bad about
ourselves.
Well,
how would you feel if your spirit animal said, no, that's a bad job, you should feel bad?
I don't know. I think I'd feel a little bad that Smitty's my spirit animal, too. But it's true. He's my spirit solderer.
All right, folks. But when we come back, we're going to go ahead and jump into the code because we want to show you what we've done. We've actually cleaned it up quite a bit because, again, remember, when we first made these steampunk goggles,
we
were just starting to work with WS2812 LEDs.
Mm-hmm.
The code was sloppy. It was mostly, you know, copy and paste and then modify for our use, which is that's what you do with Arduino.
Yeah.
But it's a lot cleaner now, and it's a lot easier to understand, and we're going to be able to go through it so that you can write your own custom animations.
Very cool.
But before we do that, you know what I want to do, Brian?
What's that?
I want to take a break for these messages. Now, we all have stuff in our house. We all have wonderful things in that place that we call our abode. And yet, when we walk away, so many of us don't really know what's going on. We don't understand what's going to be happening to our home. We don't see the people who come up to the front door. And yes, we don't have a way to keep track of our loved ones whose houses we may want to protect. At least we didn't until now with Ring. A Ring is this wonderful system. You've seen it before on this show. It's a doorbell, but it's so much more. Yes, they give you everything you need to have it installed in just a couple of minutes. That includes the tools, that includes the Ring Video doorbell. It includes an adapter plate so that you can run this off of house power rather than off the internal lithium-ion battery. But it's not just a way to bring your attention to someone at the front door. It's a way to connect to your house, to keep in contact with your house from vast differences over your phone. Now, here's how it works. Once you have this installed, it will link up with your Wi-Fi network and allow you to get a notification on your phone anytime someone comes by your front door. Not just when they ring the bell, but because it's got a motion detector, it can tell you when someone just walks up to the door, maybe peering through the windows to see if anybody's home. Now, if someone does push the button, you can start a two-way conversation. You can actually see them with a high-definition camera. You can hear them, and they can hear you. So even if you're not home, you could act like you are home. Folks, I got to tell you, when this first came out, I thought it was a curiosity. It was interesting. But then I bought one for my family in Las Vegas, and I got to say, I trust Ring with them. Over the last couple of years, what they've seen is they've seen people stealing power from my house in the summer by plugging in an extension cord while my parents were gone. They've seen UPS deliver people just throw boxes at the door. They've seen someone try to steal boxes from the houses across the way. This is all recorded in our Ring Cloud, and it's just one of these things that puts your mind at rest. It puts your mind at ease because you realize there is someone watching. Now, people have started to realize that that's a Ring Video doorbell, that's a camera at the front, and they know that those are not the houses to pick on. If you are worried about your home, if you're worried about your family, if you want to make sure you can keep an eye on your stuff at all times, then you owe it to yourself to try a Ring Video doorbell. Ring recently introduced their floodlight cam. It's the world's only motion-activated HD security camera with two high-beam LED floodlights and a 110-decibel siren and two-way talk. It's one of the things that you asked for. You said, look, the Ring Video doorbell is nice, but what about those places that don't have a door? Well, that's exactly why they created that and things like the stick-up cam. They've got customizable motion zones and dual sensors with object and facial detection. They're hardwired and weatherproofed, available in black or white, so you never have to worry about the battery going dead. And you can use the same Ring app to flash the lights, sound the alarm, and zoom into focus. It was Wall Street Journal's Best of CES 2017. And if you trust WSJ, then this is definitely something that needs to end up on your Christmas list. You can monitor every corner of your property with a Ring of Security kit, and all their kits include a Ring Video doorbell and your choice of either one, two, or three floodlight cams. And their Pro kits have a slim Video Doorbell Pro with crystal clear 1080p HD video and night vision. The Ring Video doorbell and floodlight cams install in just minutes, and working together, they provide 24/7 monitoring of your entire home, whether you're in your bedroom or thousands of miles away. Folks, join the millions of homeowners who protect their home with Ring. For a limited time, Know How listeners can get up to $150 off one of the Ring of Security kits. Just go to ring.com/knowhow. That's ring.com/knowhow. And we thank Ring for their support of Know How. Hey, Brian, you ready for some coding?
I'm ready. I've prepared my mind and my body for some coding.
All right, let's go ahead and jump on in. This is this should be familiar. This is the Arduino sketch environment. Now, we've done a couple of things. We've included one library, FastLED. That's the library that lets us access WS2812 LEDs.
Yep. It
gives us all the cool commands and shortcuts so that we can make it do what we want it to do.
Oh, we've seen that before.
Oh, we have. And we've also seen all of this. So remember, I like to define and put my variables up top.
just so that I know what are the variables that I can play with.
That's just good coding.
That's just good coding. So I've got data pin 3. That's the pin to which I'm going to connect my WS2812 string. Because remember, I'm going from one LED ring to the next, so all of them are one string. So 16 LEDs each, I've got 32 LEDs in the string.
That makes sense.
Okay. I've also got this, the number of LEDs, that's 32. I've got the brightness. Right now I have it set for 100, and the reason why I have it set for 100 is because I could go to 255, but you make it brighter, you use more power.
Right.
And also, typically the place where you use these are indoors, like in conferences. 100 is plenty bright.
Even I was going to say,
it's just overpowered.
Even under the studio lights that we have right now, it's plenty bright.
Right. I mean, look at this. So this is set for 100. It's not like you can't see that.
No.
But if you go much higher than this, it just becomes, especially on our cameras, it's just
blown out.
A blob of light.
It's blown out. It looks good at 100. So.
Right. So the other thing that you want to know is this, the speed. So this is actually, the number that you put here is in the delay. It's going to be divided by this, 1,000 divided by this number. So the higher you make this number, the less delay there's going to be.
Okay.
The less delay there's going to be, the faster the animations are going to run.
Okay.
All right. Now this is new. This is specifically for my warp core animations.
Nice.
Remember how if I'm going to use a value multiple times, I like to have it as a definition rather than typing in that value multiple times.
Right. So then if you want to go back and change it, you don't have to do it like 100 times.
Precisely. I don't want to have to change it in the 20 different spots.
Right.
Because I might forget one and suddenly it looks weird. This way, as long as I use these values, the warp red, warp green, warp blue, wing red, wing green, wing blue, all of it will look uniform.
Very nice.
And I can just change it in one place and it changes it for the entire animation.
Perfect.
All right. So the other things that we're going to do is right below here, this is the function that is going to be called that reads the potentiometer. So in the original 100 lines example that we used for the steampunk goggles, all it did was cycle through the animation. So it would run an animation for about 10 seconds and then move to the next, then the next, and the next, and go back to the top of the list.
Right.
I wanted to make it so that you could actually select which animation that you wanted to use. So what I did was this. I did an A read, which is an analog read, of 7. So I'm reading pin 7, analog pin 7. Which is connected to my potentiometer.
Right, so it's getting the signal from that.
Right, that is going to bring me back a value between 0 and 1024.
Okay.
Oh, actually, it goes all the way to 1200, but 1024
you've bracketed it out to 1024?
Right. So what I'm going to do is, that gives me my value, but then we've added this. This is a range check. Remember how we talked about how this is important? Because every once in a while, if you've got a flaky potentiometer, it will go down to less than 0, and it will go above 1024.
Right.
Which we don't want, because if it's out of range, weird things happen. Most likely the Arduino just freezes up.
Right.
So what I've done here is I've actually told it, if it goes down below 0, set it back to 0. And if it goes above 1010, set it to 1010. So absolutely guaranteed it will not go out of range. It can only go down to 0. It can only go up to 1010. So even if something funky happens on the potentiometer, it's not going to crash the Arduino out.
Cool. And so the next step is then bracketing out the different patterns between?
Precisely. Because I going between 0 and 1010 doesn't help me a lot in choosing one of 10 different patterns.
Right.
So what I've done here is I've used it's a built-in function, we've seen it before, called map. So my PAT choice, my pattern choice, is the map function run on that value I just took from the potentiometer and range checked. So from 0 to 110, because remember, that potentiometer goes from nothing, from 0 all the way up to 110. And because I've range checked it, I know it's only going to be that.
And then you do 0 to 9.
Precisely. So it does all the math for me. So it divides the range up into 10 pieces, and it says, okay, as long as you're within this and this, it stays at number 1, this and this is number 2. It does that for me.
Nice.
Which is nice. Okay, and the reason why we have 0 to 9 is because 0 is also a value, so it's 10.
It is 10, but
it is actually 10. Below this, these are the 10 different animations that I can choose from. So blank is the one that I wrote just so that it slowly goes off to off.
Right.
Then I've got rainbow. It's the standard rainbow pattern.
It's pretty.
Yeah, these are all, we've seen these all before until we get down to warp core. So warp core is new. And I created this again for the 3D printed warp core that I created for my room. All this is going to do is it's going to it's one of these, it's a follow. So it says, okay, where are you? Move one up, move one up, move one up, move one up. Every time it runs, it's going to move it to the next position.
Right. And it's the one you have running right now, isn't it?
Actually, the one that I'm running right now, this is the dual warp core.
Oh, dual warp.
Yeah, so
oh
the single warp core looks like, let me move it back a little bit. So that's the single. So this is the code we're looking at right now. What it does is imagine these two LEDs, these two were on a single strip of LEDs. So what they'd be doing is right now they'd be converging.
Right.
That's the warp core. When I go to the double, imagine this, but there's LEDs on both sides. So now it's doing it, so you can see it.
Yes, and it makes this noise too, right?
Yeah, absolutely, of course. So if you look at this, all that this is a series of if statements. It's if it's less than zero, then move it up. If it's greater than a certain level, then move it back down.
Okay.
Right? And I have warp core, and then I have warp core 2, and this is the dual-sided. These use, as you see, wing red, wing green, warp red, warp green, et cetera, et cetera.
These are the ones you defined up ahead.
Up
above.
Top. So if I change that, I can completely change how the animation looks. In fact, let's do that right now.
Don't do it. It's perfect the way it is.
Let's go ahead and plug in.
All right, fine.
Boom. There we go. We've frozen it. Okay. And let's go ahead and set it to COM4. We're going to send it to an Arduino Nano. And what shall we change it to? So right now, if you go up to my code, Alex, I've got warp red of 0. So there's no red. Yeah. There's a 100. So about half, less than half of it is green. And then all of it is blue. So let's reverse this. Let's say no blue and all red.
Yeah. 255.
And let's change this to no red, no blue, and all green.
Yeah.
Sure.
Can we make it look like the goggles in Jurassic Park? I guess if they're all green.
Yeah, actually, yeah. We just have to color match it. So it's going to compile it. And as soon as you see it freeze, it means it's going to be uploading. It's going to take a while because it's a new build. And there we go. Uploading.
That's the noise uploading makes, I'm pretty sure.
There we go. So
nice.
We changed the color. And because we use these definition of this variable down below, I only change it in one spot and the entire animation changes.
That is cool.
So much easier than trying to rewrite it every time you want to change the color.
I like it.
Yeah,
like
so this is getting closer to Jurassic Park, but I think we'd have to get rid of the red entirely.
Yeah, we have to get rid of the red, and then let's see, let's go back to the single. Yeah, that's pretty cool. You might have to change the animation a little bit to make, because I think it's spaced out a little differently.
But yeah, I don't think they show every LED. It's like every fifth LED.
Yeah,
and it just goes around and around. We can make these. I mean, I'll do that for you, Brian.
No, I want to give it a shot. Yeah, okay, so it's 4 and then rotating around. Okay.
Right.
I want to work on that. I'll try it.
Okay, so let's go ahead and take a look at the setup and the loop. This is the part where we set up the program the way that we're going to use it. Setup is super simple. We've seen this before. If you use WS2812s, it sets up the array. So remember how WS2812 works is it creates an array. Mm-hmm. You fill that array with values for red, blue, green.
Right.
So every light has a red value, a blue value, and a green value. Mm-hmm. So I fill that out. And then I do the send. So I send it down the line, and every LED will take 3 bytes representing the red, the blue, the green,
and then pass
it down the line.
Yeah, for as many LEDs that you determined.
Precisely.
Which 32 in this project.
And then my loop, remember, we want the loops to always be small. The loop should be very simple. It should call functions. It shouldn't have a whole lot in it. Mm-hmm. This is pretty dang small. So this first one is going to run the animation pattern. The second one is going to cycle the base color for the rainbow. Because I need any pattern I have that uses rainbow, I need something to say, okay, change the color of the rainbow.
Change the color of the rainbow.
Yeah. This actually checks. Every half second, it's going to call the potentiometer function that I showed you up top.
Right.
And it's going to say, what's your value? If the value changes, then it changes the pattern that it's running.
Okay.
And then down below, this is the super simple one. Once it's done all that, show the LED and then delay. And that delay is important because if I have no delay, it would just look like a bunch of really, really fast blinking lights.
Yeah, you wouldn't be able to discern it from the other one. Yeah,
precisely. Now, Brian, next week, we're going to go ahead and we're going to sit down. We're going to solder these. We're going to put it together entirely in real time so people get a sense of how difficult this is. This is actually not a difficult project. It's
fun. Once you have all the pieces together.
One thing I do want to change, though, is I've always wanted a potentiometer for brightness and a potentiometer for speed. Because I can control those.
Right.
Brightness and speed.
Yeah.
I could do the same thing with a potentiometer. But the problem is this frame isn't big enough to have another potentiometer like this one.
Right.
So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to use the cart system. I'm going to put two very small potentiometers, the screwdriver ones, the tiny little ones, so I can open up the back and adjust animation speed and brightness.
Oh, okay, yeah. I like that idea.
Just on my version.
Just on your version? Oh, we'll see about that.
Mine has to be a little bit better than yours, Ryan.
I'm wondering, too, if you could make like just an indent or like a little, and then have part of the gear extruding out, and then just use it as like an up down, like kind of almost like a volume slide for brightness.
I actually started out doing that.
Yeah. Is it really hard?
Well, the problem is it cuts into all the space I needed for my Arduino.
That makes sense. And you wouldn't be able to use the cartridge system with that either. Yeah.
This, I kind of like, seriously, the cartridge system is probably the coolest upgrade here because it really makes this flexible. In fact, if you look at this one, this is my super secret prototype version. This actually uses there's a mini breadboard in there.
What?
Yeah. So actually, it's kind of tight. Yeah. You can't really see it, but yeah, there's.
I believe.
So there we go. See, there's jumpers.
Oh yeah.
So I can very easily change the wiring on this one. I designed it that way, and you know, I kind of like that. It gives me the ability to have a finished product, but at a moment's notice, I could just change everything if I don't like it.
Well, whatever happened to you were going to do steam coming out, right? Like using some sort of vapor system. Could you do one that has a battery and that and then hot swap it, basically?
That totally works, except one time it caught on fire.
Oh. Well, you know, you got a battery strapped to your head anyway, so why not?
Who would have thought that putting a semi-flammable liquid in contact with a broiling hot coil could cause fire?
You don't know until you do it, right?
I will say it worked really cool for about 15 minutes. The problem is the coil needs to stay submerged in the fog liquid. When the reservoir ran too low,
then it
just started.
It started making a lot of smoke.
It melted the frame.
Oh wow! Yeah.
And someone's like, hey man, your goggles are smoking. I'm like, yeah, they're supposed to go. No. I think they're like on fire.
Like in a bad way. Those goggles are smoking hot.
And so I figured, you know, fire lithium ion batteries strapped around your head.
Not so
probably
good.
Not a great
not
idea.
So good. The thing that I find amazing is you got the cartridge right on the first try. Except
you had to show those. Okay.
This line of
folks,
sad prototypes.
So when you do prototyping, you're going to get this. You'll notice a lot of, so evidently this arched shape is very difficult to get right.
Yeah, they're a little messed up, Padre.
Yeah, and originally I was going to go ahead and put a bunch of, you've seen me do this kind of design before where I'll put holes in it so I can remove the amount of material I need. That fatally weakened the structure. Like these would just snap if you push too hard. And so eventually I got to something like this, which is It's a more compromised version. Mm-hmm. It's a little less space, but it's a little heavier. But at least it's pretty firm. We'll show this off next week. But when you do fast prototyping, you are gonna have a lot of fails.
That's part of it. And I'm glad you brought them in because they look like little space shuttles, and I'll probably just keep them at my desk.
We could put wheels on them and just roll them.
I'm easily entertained. Sorry.
Well, Brian, I learned this was a lot of information, and we don't want to have to make people copy code from the screen. We don't want them to make them imagine what the STL looks like.
So download the show and go frame by frame to figure out what we did.
No, don't do that. Instead, just go to our show notes. And Brian, where do they find those?
Oh, you can find those at twit.tv/KH. And they'll have links to everything Padre talked about, step-by-step instructions, a way to download the code. And while you're there, if you don't want to miss part two of this project, you're going to want to subscribe or download the episode if you haven't already.
Yeah, but don't forget that we've also got a page on the socials. What you're going to want to do is go to Google+, look for Know How Ask to Join, the very short approval process. But once you're in, you get access to almost 11,000 Kitas. That's our know-it-alls. These are the folks who are in every stage of the DIY maker spectrum, and they're going to help you.
not only are they going to help you, but they're going to give you a chance to test your guruism, your expertism. You can answer questions. You can ask questions. You can post pictures of your projects, and we'll put them here on KnowHow. Again, go to Google Plus and look for KnowHow.
And that's not the only place you can find us. If you want to see what we're doing outside of KnowHow, see what the coolest corgi gif of the week is, or what we are doing otherwise, you know, when we're not...
Not being goofy.
Yeah, it's pretty much that. You can follow us on Twitter. I am at @cranky_hippo.
And you're going to find me at @PadreSJ. And Brian cannot see out of his goggles, but I can. Because version 2, baby. Version 2 is awesome. And don't forget, we've got a third member of our crew who is also quite the maker himself. He's also going to be joining us in our Let's Solder episode next week. It's Mr. Johnny Apple.
I'm just going to be baking a chicken.
If it smells like chicken, he's doing something right.
Excuse me, Padre. You know, you think your warp core is cool? Check out this dude's warp core.
Whoa.
Actually, that is my warp core.
Oh. You found Padre's warp core on YouTube?
No, I actually took his thing over.
Oh, you did?
But my animation looks much better than his because he uses an array of just standard LEDs, and I use WS212s.
Very nice.
Well,
there we go. Well, you're gonna find Johnny at twitter.com/an.
Excuse me, Padre. That's pronounced Alex.
No, I wouldn't know that if it was
weird.
Anyways, until next time, I am Father Robert Ballas here.
And I'm Brian Burnett.
And now that you know how,
go build it. Go goggle yourself. God, it really is like staring up a unicorn's butthole.
It's the way to go.
Hold on, I need to get that steam on there.
Old should we hold still? Yeah.
Hold on, Padre needs some steam.
There you go.
I hope that...
You need to do this.
I hope
like
that
a little
steam
teapot.
Doesn't get too hot, and then uh-oh.
Wait, wrong.
Yeah, that's
it's coming from above. There you go.
These TriCasters are great, huh?
The best 15 grand ever.
Okay.
You gotta do a little teapot if you're steaming.
You gotta put the steam on his teapot. Okay, what kind of teapot is that? We filled the teapot with lighter fluid. Best use of a $1 million studio ever.
We have
fun,
don't
we? Yes, we do. Now, are you ready for next week? Because you are going to have to assemble that thing.
I'm ready.
All right.
Feeling a little toasted. Feeling the pressure.
Woo. All right, everybody, let's do this. 3, 2. This episode of KnowHow is brought to you by Tracker, a coin-sized tracking device that pairs with your smartphone and keeps you from losing your most valued possessions. Visit thetracker.com right now and enter the promo code KnowHow to receive a free Tracker Bravo with any purchase. And by the Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It's like caller ID for your house. Go to ring.com/knowhow and get up to $150 off a Ring of Security kit with their limited time offer. And by fire!
I'm getting like a nice little steam.
Yeah, that steam bath you've always
wanted
on.
Oh, it's so hot in here.
I'm still going to wear them up here, though. I mean, that's... And actually,
I think if you go to the single with the fire owl, it will look like Indiana Jones. Like, I like it though. I'm gonna put that in at the end of the show somehow.